Thompson, the cowboy mayor. 5,000 sweating, shirt-sleeved voters shook Chicago's vast Gort Theatre one night in 1927 when friendly cries of Attaboy Bill, you tell 'em, Bill, the clamour fell like a benediction on burly William Hale, Big Bill Thompson, then campaigning for his third term as mayor. He had just coined a slogan that was to ring round the world, vote for Big Bill Thompson and make the King of England keep his snout out of Chicago, he bawled. That's my message, folks. It was soon apparent that the message was a winner. Big Bill went back for his third term, a term notorious even in Chicago's turbulent history for crime, vice, and noisome scandals. Chicago lived to regret it, for it was then that a swarthy little Sicilian thug named Al Capone came to full power and built the biggest vice empire in the world. Crude, mountainous, whiskey-guzzling Big Bill Thompson was for 20 years one of the most colourful figures on the American scene. He made Chicago a byword for gang murders and political corruption. No man in America roused greater contempt or greater adulation. His enemies called him a moronic buffoon, a hoodlum, a lying bully, and a jungle hippopotamus. His admirers loved him as saintly patriot, the greatest American since Lincoln, and the cowboy knight-errant of the people. William Hale Thompson was born in Boston on May 14, 1867. He came of old pioneering stock, and often recalled that his ancestors carried muskets against the hated British in the War of Independence. Young Bill fled, at the age of 15, from the pampered life of a rich man's son to become a cowboy on the cattle ranches of Wyoming and Montana. In 1891, his father died, leaving $2 million worth of property in the booming young city of Chicago. Bill reluctantly left the cattle country to live in Chicago and look after the estate. To the end of his life, he wore a 10-gallon Stetson, rolled his own cigarettes, and bullied his underlings with boisterous cowboy curses. For some years, he enjoyed a playboy existence, yachting on Lake Michigan and starring at water polo and football. In 1900, the local Republican Party, looking for a rich young stooge, persuaded him to stand for alderman in the notorious Second Ward. The Second Ward was a warren of homes of ill fame, cheap hotels, drug dens, white slavers and criminal hangouts with names like the Bucket of Blood, the House of All Nations, and one simply called Why Not? The local party bosses were Bathhouse Coughlin, Hinky Dink Kenner, and Harry Greasy Thumb Guzik. The reeking scandal of the district came to a head when the Everly sisters opened what they claimed was the most elegant and costly house of entertainment in the world. The walls shone with gold leaf and were hung with velvet draperies, glowing in the light of glittering chandeliers. Servants in scarlet liveries ushered in the patrons. Posing as a starry-eyed idealist, Bill Thompson won his election with a pledge to kick the pimps and criminals out of his ward. Once in office, the Republican bosses found that he was a tough, power-hungry young go-getter with his eye already on the mayor's seat. Big Bill, however, was yet a child in the jungle of Chicago politics and had 15 years to wait before achieving his ambition. Eventually, he found a patron in sinister gangling Fred Poor Swede London, who by devious paths had risen from peddling phony medicines from a wagon to be the most powerful Republican politician in Illinois. London, looking for rich plunder in the vast area of Chicago, decided that handsome, bull-voiced Bill Thompson was the right man for mayor. With Big Bill's oratory hypnotizing the mob, London and his gang could sit in the background and rake in the spoils. For 2 years, London's ruthless lieutenants prepared the way with bribes and threats. When World War I broke out in 1914, Big Bill's anti-British phobia blazed into action. Not a cent, not a gun for the British, he bellowed, while Chicago's big German population cheered. He poured out lavish promises. He would have the crooks out of Chicago in 30 days. He would keep America out of the war. He would sack every corrupt official and policeman in the city. On April 26, 1915, Big Bill Thompson swept into office as mayor with a majority of 150,000 votes in a poll of 700,000 votes. He and London sat in a hotel bedroom drinking neat whiskey from tumblers as the returns came in. "We're in the trough," said London exultantly. "Now we're going to feed." While one of Chicago's religious leaders was optimistically calling Thompson the first violinist in the orchestral harmony of civic redemption, Big Bill and London were already stuffing the city payrolls with grafting cronies. In 4 months, they added nearly 10,000 temporary employees to the list. Thompson's rosy promises of a vice clean-up melted into thin air as the weeks went by. Half the Chicago police force were in the pay of Vice King Colosimo, who boasted he had 2,000 women, and the liquor barons Bathhouse Coughlin and Hot Stove Jimmy Quinn. When outraged reformers quoted statistics that Chicago had 6,400 saloons, 200 gambling dens, and 900 houses of ill fame, Thompson roared back at them, "Liars, hypocrites, four flushes, bunk!" Even after America entered the war in 1917, Big Bill continued to rave about the British murderers of American youth. He was branded a traitor and christened Kaiser Bill, while the Bishop of Texas said he ought to be executed for treason. "What this country needs is a few first-class hangings," said the bishop, "and Thompson should be first." Nevertheless, his anti-war tirades helped Thompson to be re-elected mayor in 1919. Americans were sick of President Wilson's idealism and suspicious of the League of Nations. Big Bill's America First policy carried him back to power with another huge majority. Thompson's second four-year term saw Chicago sink still further into an incredible welter of crime and scandal. Prohibition had arrived, and with it a new generation of vicious hoodlums that made Bathhouse and Greasy Thumb look like Sunday school teachers. Johnny Torrio inherited the Colosimo Empire, and in 1920 imported from Brooklyn a pitiless killer by the name of Al Capone as his personal bodyguard. He and his rivals, Mike DePike Heatler and Dion O'Banion, were soon running 25,000 cases of bootleg liquor a month into the city. The rival gangs turned the streets of Chicago into a battlefield. They hijacked each other's trucks of liquor, cut each other to pieces with machine gun bullets in broad daylight, and slaughtered in cold blood owners of cafes, clip joints, and gambling dens that refused to pay protection money. After bellowing that the crime wave existed only in his enemy's imagination, Big Bill was at last forced to act. He appointed a new police commissioner and promptly made the job a farce by refusing to prosecute the powerful crime leaders who had financed his election campaign. By 1923, even Chicago's strong stomach had had enough. Thompson, refusing to stand for re-election, disappeared on a long yachting holiday until the stench of scandal died down. He played with the idea of trying to get the Republican nomination for president, but sane Republicans rejected him with horror. Thompson was uncrushable. He abandoned poor Swede London and stood as a people's reform candidate for the 1927 mayoral election with the familiar plea that he would clean the crooks out in 30 days. The campaign was the wildest and dirtiest in Chicago's history. Johnny Torrio had fled back to Italy, bequeathing his liquor kingdom to Scarface Al Capone, who proceeded methodically to wipe out rivals and make himself sole bootleg king. In 1925, Dion O'Banion was shot in his flower shop. Among 26 carloads of flowers at his funeral was a basket of roses with a touching card, "From Al." To make his kingdom sure, Capone knew he must have the city hall in his pocket. He decided that Thompson must be mayor. A month before the election, orders went out to thousands of gangsters, pimps, racketeers and petty criminals in his empire, that by any means Big Bill was to get back to power. Meanwhile, Thompson was campaigning in his own dramatic style. He thundered about the British. "This King George, if King George had his way, there'd be a million American boys fighting the dirty Englishman's battles." Thompson's opponents replied by sending a man in a cocked hat and regimentals riding a spavined horse through the streets with a notice, "Look out, Bill, the British are coming." For weeks the fantastic carnival abuse and riot went on, while in the background Capone's faithful henchmen went around collecting campaign funds and vote pledges from terrorized citizens. On April 5, 1927, William Hale Thompson was elected mayor of Chicago for the third time. by a majority of 90,000 votes. The rest of the United States was stunned. Cowboy comedian Will Rogers cracked, "They tried to steal Big Bill with the better element. The trouble with Chicago is, there ain't no better element." From all over the country came a chorus of rage and scorn. Thompson's election was described as a national humiliation. New Yorkers said Chicago had gone mad. One newspaper quipped, "There's no accounting for tastes," as the old woman said when she kissed the cow. Thompson's third term was the heyday of the Chicago gangster. Al Capone established himself openly in 50 rooms in the Hotel Metropole with large portraits of Washington and Big Bill over his desk. His gangsters roamed the corridors of the City Hall, collaring aldermen with requests for favors and threatening those who refused to vote their way. Week after week, Big Bill thundered that he would clean out the hoodlums and grafters, but he was helpless in the meshing of the criminal machine that had put him into office. In 1927 and 1928, there were 712 murders in Chicago, an average of almost one a day. Capone's annual income from his bootlegging and ring of vice houses was over $2 million a year. Every civic department was rotten with graft. When the school superintendent protested, he was hounded from office for using pro-British textbooks in his schools. By 1930, the writing was on the wall for Big Bill. The Chicago Tribune, as a taxpayer, brought an action against him for fraud. The court ordered Thompson and his gang to return over $1 million, which had been paid to phony